everybody, Kelly here again for Thrifty Notion's Textile Talk series. If you've been keeping up, you know we've talked about cotton, we've talked about linen, and today we're going to be diving into a category of fabrics and discussing synthetics. The first thing to note about synthetic fabrics won't surprise you if you've watched our content before, because this is something that Liv and I talk about a lot. But the first thing that polyester, nylon, and acrylic all have in common is that they're all plastics. Whether or not this concept is new to you, I think that seeing some other products made out of these materials can be really interesting, and it helps drive this information home. We don't always get this technical, but I thought it might be fun this time to dig deep into our science knowledge, remember what we learned in science class growing up, and talk about how these fabrics are made.
Firstly, these fibers are all polymers, and you may remember that polymers are chains of monomers, and the monomers used to produce these materials are extracted or produced from petroleum, usually, so crude oil, but coal is also sometimes used to produce acrylic. I think it's worth noting here that both of these sources are non-renewable, and even though only a small portion of their use goes towards plastic production, this is still an element that affects the overall sustainability of these fabrics.
Once the monomers are extracted, they're processed with another chemical that leads to their polymerization, and at this point we have something like plastic chips, essentially. These plastic chips have to be either heated or treated in some way to make them pliable and soft so that they can be extruded through a spinneret, and that's what turns them into fiber. There's a few different ways this is done, and we go into a little more detail in our blog post, so if you're interested in seeing more information on that, it's linked down below. But I like to compare this to how spaghetti is made. If the plastic is our dough and the fibers are our noodles, we're taking that dough, pushing it through a machine that turns it into these long little noodles, and we can decide how short or long to cut them, and that will impact the end use of our product, how it looks, and even its properties. So that is one advantage of synthetic fibers, is that we can produce these very long fibers, much longer than most natural fibers, and that means that they are going to make a very durable fabric that resists pilling. Alternatively, as is often the case with acrylic fibers, they can be cut shorter and they can be crimped using heat, which will make them hold that shape really well. And then they can be spun into a yarn that has more little end fibers sticking out. It's going to resemble wool, and it's often used as a wool substitute because it can then be knitted into sweaters that will be very heat retentive, they will be very insulating, and they're often very soft as well. The properties of synthetic fabrics can be affected by a lot of different factors, including the fiber length, as I just illustrated with my last couple examples. But one thing you can typically expect from synthetic fabrics is that they're not going to be very breathable. If you've been here a while, you know there's usually a moment in these videos where I say, this is where it gets a little bit tricky, and this is that moment. While synthetic fabrics aren't very breathable, they can be very moisture wicking. This may seem counterintuitive, but it's typically reserved to garments that are tight fitting and knitted. So things like activewear, swimwear, and some underwear. I will say it's important to think about how tightly the garment fits to your body. If there's more distance between your body and the fabric, it's more likely that the moisture evaporating off your body will become trapped in the air in that space, and it'll make you feel clammy, warm, and a little bit extra sweaty. I encourage you to think about how your clothing makes you feel when you're wearing it. I've gotten to the point where I mostly only wear natural fibers. It has made a world of difference in my comfort level from day to day, how I feel in my clothes, and it's funny how I had so many things that I would put on and just feel a little off in, and it wasn't until I learned more about textiles that I realized it's because they're plastic and I just don't like wearing them. Some other properties of synthetic fabrics is that they aren't very heat tolerant. Because they are plastics, they can melt very easily, and there's a lot of debate in the textile world about what fabrics are best if you're in a high heat situation, because synthetic fabrics won't really catch on fire, but they will melt and stick to your skin. So I have a lot of thoughts on that, but that's something we can talk about another day. When it comes to recommended applications for synthetic fabrics, it's a little bit harder to give specific project ideas because this isn't a fabric like linen that only has a few different variations it can be made into. Synthetic fibers can be used to make anything from athletic knits to chiffon and a million other things in between. It can be used to make very thick, durable fabrics for industry uses. It can also be used to make some very thin and still very durable and strong fabrics for things like tents and hammocks. So there are some cases where these fibers are very beneficial in the world we live in and for convenience, But I will say the biggest convenience factor for these fibers is that they're very inexpensive. I think a big reason we use them so widely within the apparel and textile industries and why they're blended with natural fibers so often is because they are very cheap to produce. But it comes with some drawbacks because there are a lot of environmental concerns, but there are some cases where I think that using synthetic fabrics can be either necessary or really beneficial. And that includes things like activewear, swimwear.
Wait. We have to pause here for a second because I realize I didn't fully explain why these fibers are beneficial for these uses. But it's mostly because of the properties we discussed before, like their durability and quick drying properties, as well as the fact that they're resistant to sun damage and chemical damage more so than natural fibers like cotton. They're also often blended with other synthetics like spandex and lycra, and in combination, these fibers are going to bounce back very easily, they're going to maintain their shape, and they won't stretch out and become misshapen like cotton fabrics or some other natural fibers would.
And specifically in the cases of fabrics like satin, chiffon, tulle, and organza, you may want to reach for a synthetic option depending on what you're making it for. Personally, I prefer silk satin and silk organza, so if I can get my hands on those affordably, that's usually what I'll reach for. But if I was making a dress for a 5-year-old, I probably wouldn't do that. So there are cases where it just logically makes sense to use synthetics or where it is financially not possible to use an alternative. And then there are also cases like outdoor fabric where you could technically use a treated cotton fabric, but you know, there are times where you just need to go for the convenient option, use a synthetic material that's going to be water resistant and hold up better to sun damage, and just roll with it. So I just want to be very clear that even though we encourage the use of natural fibers here at Thrifty, we do understand that there are instances where you may need to use a synthetic fabric. We carry some synthetic fabrics that are vintage and dead stock. We would love for them to get used, so we're definitely not saying don't use them, but we do hope that you'll think about the instances that you use them in more often so that you can see if there are ways you can incorporate more natural fibers into your sewing. Lastly, I alluded to some environmental concerns related to synthetic fabrics, and this is largely related to the fact that they are plastics. Not only is the production of plastics very energy and resource dependent, but as we all know, these things do not really break down in our environment, and the breakdown that is happening is very concerning. The more that I learn about microplastics and how they affect not only our environment, but also human health, the more concerned I get. And that's something I actually want to do an in-depth video on. So keep an eye out in the coming months. I really want to do a deep dive on microplastics and talk about all the different effects they can have and some studies that have been done, because this is something that I just find really interesting in general. But I also think this is a topic that affects the sewing community even deeper than it does the average person, because when we're working with these fabrics, we're cutting them, we're breathing them in as we sew with them. Even using polyester thread, you know, we're exposed to these things and small particles of them a lot more than the average person. The more I learn, the more concerned I get. So personally, like I said, I don't do a ton of sewing with synthetics, but I do like to work with secondhand fabrics a lot. And so I do a lot of repurposing secondhand polyester scraps. And I am thinking I need a new air filtration system and maybe wear a mask while I'm working with them. So all of that to say, keep an eye out for that video. I don't know when it's coming out yet because this is a topic that I do want to do a real, genuine, deep dive into, but I'm really excited about it and I hope that it interests some of you as well. All right, you guys, that's all I have for you today. Thank you so much for being here. As always, leave your comments, concerns, or questions down below, and I will see you next time. Happy sewing!